So, without further ado, let us please enter right into the QuadJacks news for the day of Monday, March 26, 2012. Top story of the day. This is actually quite recent. Just about an hour ago, I think, it was first reported by Bloomberg News. Chad Elie, if you remember him, pleads guilty after a long legal battle. Chad Elie, one of the original 11 men indicted by the Department of Justice on Black Friday, has pled guilty in a Manhattan federal court to conspiracy, bless you, Zach, by the way, to conspiracy and deceiving banks for the purpose of transferring funds to online poker companies, full tilt poker, PokerStars and UB. This is an important turn in the defense of Elie and co-defendant John Campos because the two payment processors, as you will remember, were becoming cult icons of resistance after they kept disputing the DOJ's accusations and try to fight them and claim their innocence under a variety of creative and ever-changing pretexts. You must remember how fun this was and how much fun we had with it. And no, but he succumbs. Poor Chad. In court, Elie admitted to the U.S. District Judge Lewis Kaplan, who by now must be getting used to this. Elie said, "I know that my conduct was wrong," which I guess you have to acknowledge once when you actually plead guilty. Anyway, the maximum sentence for Elie's crimes is 5 years in prison, but under his plea agreement, he is more likely to serve between 6 to 12 months, which is kind of, I think it's only slightly underneath what the other men who have pled guilty so far stand to suffer. Everyone's, I think, approximately a year. This guy's 6 to 12 months. Anyway, he is set to be sentenced on October 3rd. Elie is now the fifth person of the 11 defendants to plead guilty since Black Friday, along with Brent Beckley, Ryan Lang, Ira Rubin, and Bradley Franzen. So there you go. It's rather meaningful. He did seem to be one of the staunchest, most resilient, you know, "Not me, you know, you're not going to get me, you're never going to get me." And today he said, reminds me of that philosopher in Crimes and Misdemeanors who just, yeah. Anyway, so that's important. And of course, a lot of people are now thinking, like, well, when is John Campos going to follow suit? Is he going to continue to profess his innocence? Is he calling Chad right now and be like, "Dude, WTF, I thought we were in this together"? Not sure, but I wonder when the same fates will await, I guess, the higher profile defendants in this case. Like, is Esai Scheinberg just going to, I guess, you know, just completely forever avoid this? Well, why wouldn't he? Unless he was moved by an almost superhuman sense of responsibility. But anyway, let's move right on. This was actually the, in my list anyway, the most important, the top news item of the day, because it's such a, some people are calling it, I think correctly, a monumental, pretty historic moment. Even though it's a small step, it's certainly meaningful. Of course, later it was moved when Elie said what he said. But anyway, Illinois introduces first online lottery. I know there's a lot of lottery buffs among our listeners, so listen up. After the Department of Justice released the DOJ memo back in September, they actually released it in December, but it was composed, written in September, I think, specifically allaying the online concerns of the New York and Illinois state lotteries, the latter has gone ahead and made lemonade. On Sunday morning, the citizens of Illinois were finally able to purchase individual lottery tickets online. And they did. It's important to make that, like, purchase online tickets online. You know, the subscription-based model for the lottery was already available in other states, but this is the first time you can actually purchase individual tickets. Wow! Let's all go to Chicago. The project is being heralded as a success so far. It's been one day. With as much as $9,000 in sales being reported for the first day alone. Among the principal beneficiaries of this revenue will be the state's school system and other public works. I like pointing that out, you know, for the naysayers, for the anti-gambling. You know, this is a good thing. And maybe it will blow and destroy the convenience stores. But kids are going to be getting, you know, more books and stuff. So that's good. There is much protest as applause. However, Anita Bedell, my girl, of the Illinois Church Action on Alcohol and Addiction Problems, forewarns of the opening of a, quote, whole Pandora's box nationwide that will devastate gambling addicts and susceptible youths. A less biblical but equally substantial fear is that of Jeff Leonard of the National Association of Convenience Stores, who admits, quote, significant concerns about how ticket-carrying stores will be affected by this. And it's important to point out this statistic. According to Lyle Beckwith, the senior vice president of government relations with the the National Association of Convenience Stores, the average convenience store customer who doesn't buy lottery tickets spends on average $6.29 per visit to the convenience store, while the average customer who buys lottery tickets spends on average $10.35 per visit. That's like, you know, that's more than $4, which I do not think is the cost of a lottery ticket. $4, that seems pretty pricey. I mean, I don't know. I seldom buy them. In fact, I don't think I've ever bought one. Full disclosure. But the extra expense, you know, obviously goes to items like sodas and snacks, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, the convenience stores are alarmed by this. So that's important to note. It's being discussed if you check the Twitter sphere and then the gaming news outlets. This is pretty meaningful. It's the first actual physical development result of the DOJ memo. Even though, yes, maybe it is just the online lottery. And I was reading an article by a fellow named Bradley Valerius, who made the observation that this is not really internet gambling, kind of. I forgot exactly what he likened it to, but it's like, it's an important step, but it's not really, you're not actually gambling online. You're buying something. You're buying something from the internet that you gamble with later. I don't know, actually. I guess if you go on to illinoislottery.com, I think you can mess around with it. Of course, if you're not actually in Illinois, you can't. But or unless, you know, that those, remember when Bodog released that anonymous table thing and they cracked it in like 5 minutes. We'll see. But that's kind of important, you know, now that I think about it. That I don't normally do this, I guess. You know, I don't, look at the first two items, the first two news items. We had Chad Elie, the Black Friday guy, number one, and the number two, the Illinois. I remember the Illinois lottery was going to be number one. And usually I keep it at number one. To me, most of the time, the developments and the progress of the post-Black Friday world, this era of reconstruction, a renaissance almost, new beginnings, new hope, change we can't believe in, etc., etc. To me, that's more newsworthy. That's more typically more important than keeping track of the debris left behind by Black Friday and that which pertains to the overthrown regime. In this case, Chad Elie would certainly be a member of the oligarchy, which I hope I'm pronouncing correctly. I've never pronounced that word correctly. But because, you know, because it's Chad Elie and he's been making such a fight of it, you know, I thought that was probably something to point out before. The Illinois thing, but I still do think that the Illinois thing is very important, and so you can see how different the news items are. You know, one is like, boy, things just continue to collapse for that group of people. It's like death over here and then birth over there. So that's, keep that in mind, because I think that's going to mark the news canon, the news cycle for many months, if not years. It's when it comes to online gaming. Although I do think that the post-Black Friday fallouts will decrease in relevance as time goes by, which is only natural. Finally, this is not really news, but I thought that I would include it in the news update because I think it's a very interesting observation. Let me just throw this at you. Here we go. Limit of Sheldon Adelson's influence. Limit of his influence is evidenced by Newt Gingrich fiasco. Yes, I'm sorry. I called it a fiasco. Maybe that's premature. I thought it would convey the gist of it. And here's what I mean. Sheldon Adelson, chairman and CEO of the Las Vegas Sands Corporation, and according to Forbes, the seventh richest man in America, became the face of homegrown opposition to online poker in December of last year, when it was reported that the Las Vegas and Macau casino magnate would oppose efforts to legalize online poker in the United States due to concerns about player protection. John Ralston, author of the original report, pointed to Adelson's for the purpose of this news item, pointed to Adelson's extensive influence in the U.S. Congress as a primary reason why online poker advocates like ourselves should be discouraged. While Adelson's technophobia alarmed mostly our own poker community, the man made much wider national headlines at the beginning of this year when he and his family ended up donating approximately $20 million to the presidential campaign of Republican nominee Newt Gingrich. But despite a few smatterings of momentum, I like that word, smattering. Never heard it used in a plural. Anyway, despite a few smatterings of momentum, Newt Gingrich's campaign never really took off, and he is almost, I dare say, a non-person today in the media's coverage of the Republican presidential contest, as he has won nothing of any real significance after the South Carolina primary in January. Therefore, a new editorial in the Las Vegas Sun by J. Patrick Kulikin, I saw him on Week in Review last week, attempts to allocate how these millions upon millions of Adelson's campaign dollars could have been put to better use. So that's the point of the editorial. But it made me think that, you know, this guy, Sheldon Adelson, was supposed to be this monster almost, with all due respect to Mr. Adelson. But he was, in our eyes, he was this monster against online poker who was going to skew everything his own way, and then he gives all this money to Newt Gingrich, and oh my god, now Newt Gingrich is going to rise like King Kong or Godzilla, and the observation made by the Las Vegas Sun, actually I just made it, may provide a modicum of relief to those impressionable souls within our battered community who feared that the omnipotent Sheldon Adelson dictated the future of everything. While his wealth and power must certainly be acknowledged, one man's efforts could not ultimately overcome longer odds. As Kulikin puts it, quote, Newt's poll numbers were hampered by the thing that has always plagued Gingrich. The American people resoundingly do not like Newt Gingrich. Adelson, however, should not be considered wholly neutralized yet. He has since pledged that he would support whichever Republican candidate. And as it's now a race between Mitt Romney and Rick Santorum, both of whom have declared staunch opposition to online gaming, the pro-online poker forces must continue to track the movements of Mr. Venetian's money and associations. Yes, I'm sorry, I omitted mentioning Ron Paul. I'm sorry I did that. You will pardon me. I'm referring chiefly to the mainstream media coverage of this contest. I did not mean to disrespect the Ron Paul supporters out there. Please do not think of this as a conspiracy. QuadJacks is not doing its part to suppress the message of the representative Ron Paul, and good luck to all of those who deserve it. So, but that's kind of that. I thought that, you know, merited mention of Sheldon Adelson. Now that doesn't mean like, oh well, he couldn't make Newt Gingrich win, but so now he's just completely useless. No. I think this is not so much evidence of Mr. Adelson's vulnerability. Not really. I guess it's mostly proof of the strength what's the word I'm looking for here? I don't know, I'm just going to stick with strength, of the will of the American people. You know, if they don't like something, then they're not going to support it, like Newt Gingrich. If Mr. Coolican is correct and the American people just don't like Newt Gingrich, then there's nothing that Sheldon Adelson can do to give us Newt Gingrich. We don't want him. I'm speaking on behalf of those who are not, who don't want him. Not so much as supporters who obviously do. But I hope that works. I hope that works both ways, though, because, you know, if the American people want online poker, then hopefully then they can get online poker, irrespective of any resistance or obstruction which Mr. Adelson may put on our in our path. So that's kind of encouraging. We have two encouraging news items today, and one, I don't know, but Chad Elie is, I guess it's discouraging for those who are rooting for him and the Black Friday clan to succeed or defeat the DOJ to spite it. So I guess that's kind of discouraging, but I don't think so. But, it's just whatever, you know. But a valiant effort on their parts, though. They should be commended for that. And who knows, a couple of days I might come up here and say the exact same thing about John Campos. But I guess that's life. Well, that does it for the QuadJacks news update for today, March 26, 2012. Thank you for listening to QuadJacks News.